we're going to be discussing Cobra Kai season 4. This takes place here. We have Daniel and Johnny teaming up to take on Terry Silver, which was teased in the last season. Terry Silver, who was the villain of Karate Kid 3. And what was funny about
who? Yes. First off, Karate Kid 3 is not a good movie in any sense of the word. But what makes that movie entertaining to watch is the performance of Thomas Ian Griffith as Terry Silver, who this series, they confirm that dude was coked out of his mind the entire movie. Yeah. And it, you watch clips from it, it makes sense.
Oh, yeah. You know, so I like they made that canon.
Because everyone else is kind of playing it straight, and Griffith is kind of playing it like he's in the Looney Tunes.
Yeah. And it's funny about that as well. It's like he's supposed to be like, I'm the big bad adult bullying the little teenager, even though Ralph Macchio was older than him. Like, Ralph Macchio was like 27. And then
Ralph Macchio was like a year older than Thomas Ian Griffith.
Yeah. So it was like that also added to the hilarity of it. I haven't seen Karate Kid 3. I've seen the first Karate Kid and the second Karate Kid, which I just watched the second Karate Kid not that long ago. I think I watched that like a year ago. That's my first time ever seeing it. And that's the one where Daniel, goes to Japan, goes to Okinawa. So that was pretty, so I thought that was kind of a pretty good sequel, I thought. I know maybe some people...
Yeah, Karate Kid 2 is legitimately great.
Yeah, it is. So I like that quite a bit. 3, I've never seen that one, and the 4th one I've never seen. I think the 4th one is considered the worst one.
Oh, the next Karate Kid. It's like tied between worst with 3 and the next Karate Kid with Hilary Swank.
Yeah, I hear that one's probably generally considered the worst. And we're also going to get into maybe discussing later if maybe she's going to return, maybe if they can try to get Hilary Swank back, maybe. So with this season, like we said, Daniel, Johnny teaming up because Kreese, and that, because of their team up, Kreese is like, well, I need a guy on my own. I need a good, right-hand man. Let me go back and get my old right-hand man from Vietnam, the guy who helped me before, the real money behind Cobra Kai, Terry Silver. And, he goes to him. And at first, Terry Silver is, kind of like, he's living a peaceful life. He's like, man, I'm done with all that shit.
He's like at peace. It's confirmed that after the events of the third movie, he hit rock bottom, went to rehab, got his life together.
Yeah, he pulled a Robert Downey Jr. He was like, he just realized like, man, I gotta do better. You know what I mean?
I spent months torturing a teenager over a high school karate tournament.
Yeah, someone right with me, mentally. I gotta change. Yeah. I gotta change everything.
He tortured a teenager he'd never met over a karate tournament.
Yeah, so he had to do better. Had to change, and now he's living this good life, still living rich. Hanging out with other rich people, and it takes Kreese to kind of come and kind of shake things up in his life to finally go like, okay, finally, I will return. I will be back. And I will be, with a part of Cobra Kai again. And so I thought that was good. I think, I will say, it kind of starts off a little weird because it starts off right immediately after season 3 where we saw Johnny and Daniel in front of the class getting ready to teach. And then, so that's the very first episode. And they don't have any lesson plan. They don't have any type of program ready. You think, like, if they're going to agree to teach this class together, that... They would
try to get on the same page, but I think that's a thing with both of their characters. They both think it's going to be super easy teaming up, and they still haven't worked out their own issues with each other. So of course, hilarity and comedy ensues.
So I thought that was kind of a little weird, and I think kind of one of the negatives about this season is the bickering between Johnny and Daniel. I think them so close together this time, because in other past seasons it would kind of come and go because they weren't always immediately in the same vicinity, but now since they're training together and trying to train their students and everything, it's like now they're in each other's spaces. It's just the bickering kind of back and forth. It's just a little repetitive, I think, this season, and a little kind of not as good as probably past seasons. It's like, okay, you two are grown-ass men, and you just really bickering back and forth
I think that's the point. On paper, they are grown-ass Man, but both of them are still kind of stunted from the stuff they went through back in high school.
And
that's the very big thing about the character of Johnny's character, that he is kind of a man-child. He's stuck in the 80s.
I think when we first talked about Cobra Kai, I mentioned, like, Johnny's a guy that was frozen in carbonite. I mean, he's just now been broken out. I mean, he's still stuck in 1984. You know, and
yeah, what Austin Powers was for the 60s, Johnny Lawrence is for the 80s,
pretty much. I mean, because he listens to the same music, you know, watches the same movies, you know what I mean?
Watches Iron Eagle over and over again,
yeah, you know, only talks about 80s movies. It's like, you know, that's he just lives in that permanent mode and he's forever that guy. And I think what the show does is it really mixes the nostalgia well with the older characters, the newer characters. We talked about that. Something that a lot of series struggles with. You know, we just saw it done very successfully in No Way Home. And we can see where it can go off the rails in something like maybe Ghostbusters or Star Wars. And I think this does a good job at advancing the, you know, quote unquote lore, I guess if you want to call it, of Karate Kid. And, you know, adding new things to it, like the way Daniel learns different techniques in the martial arts. It's like, well, he didn't know everything about Miyagi style. And then in the prior season of when he went to Japan, went back to Okinawa and met with Chosen, it's like, well, you don't really know everything about, you know, about Mr. Miyagi and about his teachings and about the family and everything like that. Yeah, you still got quite a bit of stuff to, you know, other stuff to learn. So I thought that was pretty nice. So the way they're adding more things to it, I think, is also nice. What do you kind of think about it?
Yeah, I think what works about the mixing of nostalgia here versus in something like Ghostbusters and Star Wars is, besides the first two movies, the other Karate Kid films aren't looked at that fondly. Mm-hmm. They were kind of more just like this insane cult classic, and in the case of at least three, it became one of those so bad it's good movies. And I think it works better when you're mixing in the nostalgia there, and you have the advantage of this show 40 years later, and you have the advantage of perspective, and you can explore all of these, like, on paper, very two-dimensional characters like Chosen was, like Terry Silver, even Johnny Lawrence, or to this season, even John Kreese, who I thought his characterization is much better handled than in the previous season. And mostly because last season, Kreese was playing a supervillain. He was basically like Thanos. And here you have the chaotic evil that is Terry Silver.
Yeah. Yeah. Because there's a lot of points in this season where Kreese is kind of looking at Silver. It's like, wait, is that how I am to people?
It's like, yeah. It's like, oh, fuck, what have I done?
Yeah, is that how people see me? Is, like, that how people kind of perceive me? Is, like, he's kind of constantly looking at him, like, weird, like, with a side eye going, like, okay, sure, I guess, you know. So, you know, I think, you know, Thomas Ian Griffith coming back as Terry Silver does a great job. You know, looks really good.
Oh, he's incredible in this season.
Mm, yeah, and, you know, still, you know, looks really good. You know, all the older actors, I think, all look really good. You know, William Zagba, Ralph Macchio still looks, you know, Ralph Macchio at 60 still looks really great. You know, Martin Cove is Kreese, you know, at 75 years old. It's like, yeah, I mean, you know, if you want to aspire to, you know, be an older guy, it's like, you know, a lot of these guys are kind of the template, you know what I mean? Because they look, you know, really good, still can do the moves pretty well. So that's pretty awesome. And yeah, him coming back, Terry Silver, you know, brings that same energy back, you know, from, you know, Karate Kid 3 and being this kind of crazy character. Because even though I haven't seen the movie,
he's not really bringing that same energy. It's more akin to something more scheming. Like, he's basically more like a Littlefinger than he is anything that he was in Karate Kid 3.
Okay.
Because Karate Kid 3, he is basically playing the Joker.
Okay. Maybe I have to really fully check it out, because I've only really seen clips of him.
He is a coked up Joker in Karate Kid 3. It's insane and wonderful.
Okay. I really like to, you know, kind of have him back in there. And to get to some of the younger characters, see where they are now. I like how some of the characters, like, I think part of this being a show, too, also helps Cobra Kai, as opposed to the other things being movies, because that's sometimes tough, you know, to try to really bring in the movies and I think to really flesh out stories and try to do the nostalgia stuff. This show is able to kind of do that and really flesh out some of the characters and to see kind of characters, you know, progression. Like, for instance, like Hawk, to see kind of he's made full circle where... at first he was the bully teenager, then he went through his psycho revenge phase, then he kind of, you know, went like, okay, maybe I see the error of my ways, I'm going to fix it, but then now to being humbled and then, you know, kind of coming all the way full circle again, back to kind of, you know, being where he was at first, but being a little bit more balanced. I thought that was really nice, you know, with the Hawk character.
Yeah, he was probably had one of the best character arcs of the entire, of this season and the show. And seeing that progression, that slow descent initially from, it's kind of like that rise and fall and rise again story.
And yeah, just kind of see where he was. And I think the show, you know, also has, you know, those good themes of toxic masculinity and, you know, using the karate stuff of, you know, because being the bully teenager, you know, being the bully nerd, you know, yeah, you want to, you know, enact revenge, right? You know, you want to get the person back for what you're doing. And them talking about the styles of both, you know, Miyagi-Do and Cobra Kai. And, you know, I think, you know, bringing up Star Wars, it does the whole Sith versus the Jedi thing almost better than what the Star Wars movies have done it with the prequels or with the sequel trilogy because of getting into, like, you know what? You know, people like these younger characters realizing, like, this stuff is kind of stupid, really. I mean, like, okay.
Yeah, this kind of binary nature of how both Johnny and Daniel are teaching them, it's kind of bullshit. And the real solution comes somewhere in the middle with them mixing both styles.
Yeah, which I thought was really good, you know what I mean? They kind of come up, they, you know, do the whole Grey Jedi thing here of, you know, kind of combining both the styles. And realizing, yeah, because both of these guys, these are older guys stuck in their ways, you know, and they don't know how to really process anything else other than just their way, because that's the way they've been doing it for years and years and years. And I think what's interesting to see, like, hey, sometimes old dogs can learn new tricks, like with the Kreese character, of seeing him kind of go through a little bit more of a progression here and see, like, yeah, I mean, I keep repeating the cycle over and over again. And, you know, and to learn more about Kreese and that he actually genuinely does care about Johnny. Like, he actually does really love Johnny and really did see him as probably like a son, you know, and, you know, as a, you know, kind of one of his sons or something like that. So that was kind of, I thought, really good.
And even little moments with a lot of the younger characters now, like he had that connection with Tori in the previous season where, yeah, her landlord was kind of like being really pervy with her, which... gross. Right. And Kreese did his thing and solved that and kind of becoming a new mentor figure to Robbie this season.
So you know he's got, it's just that he's got his own way of doing things and his own view of, you know, the way he sees the world due to his upbringing, due to the way, you know, he grew up, you know, and he's just been stuck in that same cycle over and over again. And he hasn't been able to break out of it or see the error of that ways. And I think, you know, having these younger characters come in here and, you know, show these older people, it's like, hey, this is a little bit the error of your ways here a little bit. While also the older characters still being there to lead and to be wise and to also mentor when they need to. And then coming to, like, to see when we talk about progression of a lot of characters, Dimitri, to see where he was from season two to where now, like, that's also a really cool story, because...
hey, the man got himself in karate, he built up his confidence, he got laid.
Yeah, you know, he's with the popular girl, you know, that was the bitchy mean girl from the first season. You know, she got humbled and you know what I mean? You know what I mean? In the first season. So even she kind of went through her own little progression a little bit. I will say the one person that stayed the same throughout the entire show is the first bully. The guy who was like the original first bully of the show.
Yeah, he was a douchebag and he was always going to be a douchebag. No matter how many times he gets his ass kicked throughout the series.
Oh, yeah. I mean, it's like he's learned nothing. He's got his ass whooped multiple times in the show by different people, and he still hasn't learned anything. Like, like we talked about other people in the show, they get beat up, they lose bad, and they go like, oh, damn, okay, maybe I got to rethink things, but not him.
That just shows that some people can't be humbled.
Yeah, you know what I mean? He's sometimes once an asshole, always an asshole, I guess. It's just, he can't be humbled. What's his name? His name was,
Kyler, who's, it's a character named Kyler. He's played by, Joe Seo.
Okay, yeah. He stayed the same throughout the whole show. It's just like, yeah, still an asshole. And there's a new character that gets introduced. Well, there's actually a couple new characters that get introduced this season, but one main one that gets introduced this season is a character called Kenny, who's this smaller kid. He's first getting into high school. His he's kind of part of a military family, army brat. Dad mm-hmm. moves around a lot because of the military. So he comes in his first day of high school, and you know he meets and then school bus tries to pick him up. And he's, the kids catch him dancing, you know what I mean? Which is like, oh, Jesus. He's really getting into it.
He's getting into it. And the entire time I was like, oh, come on, man.
Yeah. And it's a while before he finally turns around and goes, like, oh, shit. And every kid, of course, you know what I mean, is just absolutely just roasting the kid for dancing and everything like that. And he was really like, he was doing the Michael Jackson, grabbing his crotch and pointing in the air. And he was really getting into it, too. I'm like, damn, bro. Like, you know what I mean? Standing on his tippy toes. And
hey,
like,
kids got rhythm. Good for him.
Yeah. So that leads to him being bullied by no other than, Anthony LaRusso.
No other than Daniel's shithead son.
Yeah.
Who, I know this is the show of trying to find redemption in flawed people, but I couldn't wait for that little fucker to get his ass whooped. I hated that kid.
Yeah, and to see kind of like he's one of those characters that I really kind of hated up until a little bit at the end a little bit, but he's one of those kind of annoying kids, always on their screens, always on the phone, just completely lives in the kind of the screens and everything like that. And it's funny when one of Daniel's cousins, his sister or it was his girlfriend.
It's one of his cousins.
It's one of his cousins. And, she kind of comes over and they think like, okay, well, what does she know about therapy and everything? And she breaks it all down. It's like, well, maybe Anthony has a codependent relationship with screens because you're always busy and you're doing this. And maybe it's really your fault that the way he is. Like,
and one of the funniest moments of the season is she does like this little test by writing on their like notepad, and his wife just grabs it and is like, this is the test.
Yeah.
And you failed.
Yeah. I thought that was pretty funny, even though that's a kind of an old kind of thing they have sometimes in the shows with you have a therapist character and the therapist character is writing down something and the person's always, well, what are you writing? Mm-hmm. Let me see. You know what I mean? They're always trying to, figure out what the person's writing on there. That's kind of an old thing that sometimes mm-hmm. they do and stuff, but I thought it still worked here. And thought it was pretty good. And speaking of kind of, the two parents, Daniel LaRusso, I want to talk about Amanda is her name, right? The wife?
Yes. Amanda LaRusso is played by Courtney Hengeler.
Yeah.
I think that's how you pronounce her name.
Who I've always really liked her character. I thought she was mm-hmm. always really good. Always good voice of reason in the show.
She's kind of like... our audience surrogate, because she's the one person on the outside looking in at this insane like karate gang rivalry that's going on in her town. Yeah. And how it's like completely turned her life upside down, how like last season the big rumble was in her house.
Yeah, you know what I mean? And here you see kind of like, she's trying to do her best to, keep it all together, protect her daughter, especially after what happened, especially from Tori. Was the one,
who's like turned into a little psychopath almost. And this season, I think she kind of gets more character development, because season 3, she was just straight up psycho.
Yeah. So like you said, that's what the show does. I mean, it takes characters, they go through their psycho revenge phase, and then more as, another season happens, then they're like, okay, well, let's see, you kind of understand their point of view more. And she's living she is living a rough life. She's trying to do her best, taking care of her family. Her mom is sick. She's the breadwinner, and mm-hmm. she has to juggle that and go to school and do the karate stuff. You know what I mean? Like, she's, you know, she needs some outlet. You get why she wants to do the karate skills, because, like, okay, yeah, she wants to punch something, you know?
Yeah, and in credit to Peyton List, she gets a lot of... She manages to incite a lot of empathy out of Tori, a character that I wasn't a big fan of when she debuted in season two, but she's giving a fantastic performance. And when she has that that little exchange with Robbie, Tanner Buchanan's character, about why she is, like, so gung-ho about karate, it comes to that, like, thing as a teenager. It's like, yeah, knowing that I was the best at something is huge.
Yeah, you know. And, you know, from her perspective, you look, you know, when she's looking at another character like Samantha Russo, who's the daughter, it's like, well, she's lived this privileged life,
the,
you know?
The rich girl who's kind of got, like, everything handed to her. And, yeah, there will be some resentment there.
Yeah, you know, so it makes sense, you know, why there's a little bit of a rift there, you know, between the two, and just getting off on the wrong foot. But to see the relationship that kind of sort of develops a little bit with Amanda LaRusso. Hey, what's going on there, Dusk? How are you, man? Glad you could come in.
Hi, buddy. Got caught up in traffic.
Ah, no problem. We're talking about Cobra Kai season 4 here.
Awesome.
Yeah, we'll let you jump in here in a minute. So yeah, you know, with the, you know, see the relationship that develops with Amanda and Tori is really good, and to see kind of that relationship, I thought was cool in the season. I think, yeah, with a lot of these different characters, they're all, you know, very good to watch and see the progression of them. Mm-hmm. And I think that's what makes it different from, even though there's a lot of soap opera teen drama going on, you know what I mean, with hookups and relationships and people going back and forth.
Yeah, make no mistake, this is very much, if it wasn't coming on YouTube Red or Netflix, it probably would have ended up on the CW, because it does kind of have that feel of a show, but, you know, with actual solid writing for what it is.
Yeah, and I think the difference is, you know, between this and, I think, a CW show, because I watch the CW shows, you know what I mean? And I think the difference is...
Very guilty pleasure.
Yeah, you know, and I think the difference is you really do enjoy the characters, and you like seeing them progress through all the kind of different seasons. Dust, what did you think about Cobra Kai season 4? What did you kind of think about the season?
I enjoyed the difference in dynamics. They kept these things kind of going through this season. It was also nice seeing Johnny having just kind of a different students to work with, so that was nice seeing. You're right, a lot of the drama for high school is very much the same, and there are some beats that they have done again, especially with Johnny. Is he doesn't seem to be learning the lessons that you thought he would learn by now, and that kind of caught me a little off guard, like, so you just haven't learned anything the last two seasons, but okay, whatever.
Well, he is also an emotionally stunted man-child, so I don't think he has the maturity to kind of learn.
True, I understand that, and that's why I'm not holding it too against him, because I understand where he's coming from in that regard, or at least I understand where he's coming from, seeing his character as he's been. I do like the dynamic between Kreese and Silvio. They're very interesting villains, at least from the dynamic of them kind of working off of each other. And this is kind of weird, like, captain and private kind of going back, kind of in relationship. And it's interesting. And that's probably one of the more interesting aspects, is just them, how they handle Cobra Kai and how they handle it so differently.
Yeah. And when they do the, I'll say another negative is, when they do the flashback sequences to Vietnam, I mean, that's... It's somebody's backyard. I mean, it looks like somebody's backyard. It don't really look like, you know, really, I mean, good job. But, I mean, hey, it's they do what they can, you know what I mean? I don't know how big the budget is on this show, but, I mean, you know, it's whatever. I mean, that's a small complaint, you know, what they do when they do the flashback sequences to show Kreese and Silver back in the Vietnam War there.
Well, with a show like this, you could have to imagine... Most, if not all, of the production budget is probably going to the stunt coordinator and the stunt team and the fight coordinators, because this is some of the best the fighting has ever looked in this show.
Absolutely. When they do the karate tournament, this is probably the best karate tournament that you'll ever see in any of the Karate Kid anything. The movies, the season of the show, anything.
Yeah, it feels epic. And the writers for this season, they actually did some research and learned how Karate Kid tournaments actually work. A lot of them are based on skills competitions, like kata, like weapons demonstrations and stuff like that. And all of that looked really good.
Yeah.
And especially in the final two episodes, much like it did with the first season, I genuinely did not know who would win, which is one of the great things about this series.
Yeah, because the big thing that's on the line this season with the tournament is that whoever loses, they have to end, you know, their dojo. So
yeah,
you know,
it's a loser leaves town situation with the dojo.
Yeah. Hey, how's it going there, Sean? How you doing there, man? Good to see you in the chat. Hope you're doing well. Hey, we're just talking about Cobra Kai there. Yeah, it's a loser leaves town situation, and that's also another thing about the show. You also see, like, as things, we talk about progression in the show, you also see, like, the people in the town be more aware of who these people are and be, like these are, like, some dangerous outlaws or something like that. Yeah. Because there's such...
It is a gang at this point.
Yeah, you know what I mean? Because there's certain situations...
They might as well just do, like, the Sharks and the Jets from West Side Story.
Yeah, I mean, because, yeah, there's totally certain situations, like, they're talking in a shop, and then the shop owner's like, hey, man, you just can't be sitting around.
You gotta buy something.
Yeah, and he just turns around and like, what'd you say? And he's like, oh, man, well, hey, man, yeah, take your time, man, you know, hey, man, you know, you want something while you wait, I'll give you a magazine, man, you know, it's like, Jesus Christ. Like, these people that afraid of people doing mall strip karate, like, Jesus Christ, a whole town crippled in fear by mall strip karate.
By strip mall karate.
What kind of you thinking of the fighting in this season, Dusk?
I agree. There was a lot of open, wide choreography, similarly allowing a lot of just the audience just to see the moves. A lot of the previous seasons, they were limited by their budget, so a lot of it were quick cuts. Some moments where some of the characters could show their moments, where they land a kick or move or hit or turn, but they were very careful with their choreography in this. This is clearly where most of the budget went for this season. They did their research, they upped their game a bit more, and they went, all right, we can't really top ourselves as much as we kind of did with season 3's finale, Christmas finale. So this season, we're just going to go for broke for the tournament. Mm-hmm. And they did a very good job of that being a overall nice balance of choreography, character, little moments, little shout-outs to previous, Karate Kid canon, I guess this is referred to as now.
I think it helps that a majority of the actors actually train martial arts. Like Jacob Bertrand actually trains in karate, so does Tanner Buchanan. Jolomer Duenia, he's done a bunch of stunt work, especially now that DC confirmed that he is going to be Blue Beetle.
Yeah. Mm. Great casting, by the way. Yeah, the actor who plays Miguel is going to be Blue Beetle. I think that's fantastic casting.
That makes a lot of... That works a lot, especially for the new interpretation of Blue Beetle.
Yeah. And yeah, a lot of the choreography looks a lot better here than I think it's done in previous seasons. I think when they do the tournament, yeah, a lot of the choreography looks a lot better.
It's looked better with each progressing seasons, I think in large part because you have the cast just training more and more in preparation for each scene.
Yeah, very much so. Some of the stuff, like when you do some of the karate with the older actor, like the scene where Daniel Russo takes on like the four guys, you know what I mean? It's like, okay.
Oh, yeah.
You know, you gotta...
It looked fine.
It looked okay, but it was still
It looked fine. It looked believable for a guy in his 60s being able to beat up a bunch of drunk hockey players.
Yeah, you know, it was kind of decent, but it was kind of like, okay, this is kind of really slow, and he's kind of got like, okay, take the one guy, hold him real quick, you know what I mean? It's like, okay, but I think, yeah, I mean, there's some little stuff like that, but I still think they look really good. I thought this was a really strong season. You know, some of the, kind of the newer additions with the cast, like the Kenny character.
Yeah, he has one of the most heartbreaking turns in this show.
Yeah.
And by the end of the series, he becomes... scary.
Yeah, and you again, that's however, what the show does.
It is cathartic on one level, that his one of his last scenes, but it's also a little scary.
Yeah, I mean, because that's what this show does. It's like you understand the reasoning behind why someone goes to Cobra Kai, and that instant feeling, because, you know, like we mentioned before, of the the nature of the toxic masculinity and the wanting to feel powerful, wanting to feel strong again after you've been so kind of weakened and felt so weak. And especially that kid, I mean, he was walking around, his eyes was all bugged out, shaking. I mean, even when even when he's trying to practice and train, it's like, dude, I'm not going to hit you. Relax. He can't even stand in a circle. It's like, kid, I'm not going to hit you. And he's just running back. It's like, Jesus.
Which, yeah, anybody who's done any kind of training and striking, that'll bring some flashbacks.
Yeah, you know. And also, you know, another thing you got to kind of stretch, you know, kind of believability with is the fact, because, like, when he first comes in to train, they're like, well, we can't do it because the tournament, I think they said the tournament's in, like, 3 months or 2 months or something.
Yeah, they said, like, 6 months.
Okay, 6 months. And then, I guess, over the course of, like, the two episodes, three episodes, all of a sudden, he's doing combos, he's doing strings. I'm like, okay, I guess, you know, given, you know, the
this amount of time. This is movie world.
Yeah.
This is Karate Kid world.
He also apparently has no meeting up with his parents whatsoever. Not even his own mother shows up. He doesn't get any form of guidance, and he can just go and waste his time after school every single day learning to create combos.
Hey, it's 2020. Kids don't talk to their parents.
Yeah.
God forbid.
Yeah. But yeah, and another new character that gets introduced, because, you know, when they introduce the skills competition, they also introduce, like, a women's division with it as well. So now, like, each, you know, team has to have, at least one woman on their team. Johnny, mm-hmm. you know, he's trying to get a woman and recruits a woman who's, like, a girl mm-hmm. who's a debater. And also, it was funny when Johnny was trying to recruit women and going to the high school field and running.
That made me so uncomfortable, and I think the joke was that, hey, shouldn't we be calling the cops right now?
Yeah, you know what I mean, like it's also, again, stretching believability that this grown man who doesn't even have a kid who goes to that school can just appear on the field while they're practicing and training with these girls, and he's just like, okay, sure. But it made for a funny scene, you know, that was kind of funny. But, you know, the kind of this new character that gets introduced, like this girl who's a debater and everything like that, and she kind of comes on and she knows all about this, you know, all about fighting, the history of these action movies,
all about action movies, and that character was kind of awesome.
Yeah, I thought she was really cool. I liked her coming on there. Dusk, what did you feel about the new characters in this season?
I think they do a serviceable job. I'm actually a little surprised in some of the directions that they went with, not in a bad way. Some of them were predictable, other ways they weren't. They took interesting turns. Kevin was an interesting direction. I like the parallels they played with the original movies and how that can go horribly wrong. Miguel is the positive way in which that can go, and he is the negative.
Hmm.
I also like that the LaRusso kid finally has something to do after four seasons.
Yeah.
And it only took a growth spurt in a... I like the little line with Johnny gave him where he said, who are you? He's like, I'm the kid. You're the LaRusso kid? And he goes, yeah, it's called a growth spurt. And I'm like, yeah, okay.
Yeah, between like season 2 and 3, that the actor actually went through a growth spurt, lost some weight. I was shocked. Wait, is that the same kid?
Yeah. Well, that's what happens. Yeah, that puberty hits you. Yeah. I thought I thought this was a good season. I thought, like, you know, announcing, like, okay, Terry Silver is going to be here, which we, you know, teased at the last season. I'm like, well, it seems like, yeah, this is where the natural conclusion is going to be, Johnny and Danny teaming up and finally working things out, and then they're going to beat the big bad villains. But it's like, no, they actually developed some more stuff here, some more good content that we could see develop, you know, turn into maybe 1-2 more seasons. I think they said they're planning, they're definitely doing a season 5 that's already in production.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, probably it's already been announced that they're in season 5.
Yeah, and they're already going to go to season 6, they said, possibly. So, yeah, and
let's bring them all. Get next Karate Kid. Bring her in, too.
Yeah, I mean, that's the only movie they have in reference to.
Yeah, Hilary Swank hasn't been up to much lately. But just keep Jaden Smith the fuck away from this.
Yeah. Aww. Yeah. It's a different continuity.
Yeah, different continuity. That was a reboot, remake, so you can't, yeah, so you can't really reference that one too much. But, yeah, Hilary Swank, come back. You ain't doing nothing, you know what I mean? You know, you doing movies where you, you know, framing black people for murder and shit like that. You might as well just come and do Karate Kid, you know what I mean?
Wait, when was that?
That was that movie she did with Michael Ealy.
Fuck, I forgot about that movie.
Yeah, yeah, she was doing okay, that.
That movie is awesome.
Yeah, I laughed at that. That movie was pretty good. I liked
that movie. That movie was fucking awesome.
Yeah, so you might as well just come and, you know what I mean, do this Karate Kid real quick. Make a quick little cameo, come in, you know what I mean? You know, train, you know, with some of the, you know, other characters here. That'd be pretty awesome to see. I've never actually seen, like I said, I've never seen the next Karate Kid, but, Dusk, have you ever seen the next Karate Kid?
I have, actually.
You know, what could they bring in from the next Karate Kid with the Hilary Swank character, you think?
Well, she also got to know Mr. Miyagi. She got to see his different, a slightly different side with him. She also got to know the monks at the temple that he, worked with, Japanese monks. She also got to know ancient longbow that he demonstrated. I mean, at one point, he gets a bow shot at, an arrow shot at him, and he catches it with one hand. She also learned a lot about balance and letting things go and other things. So there's a couple of things they could bring in from Miyagi-Do and other sides that he didn't necessarily show Daniel's. Daniel got a lot of the, like, all right, defense, don't be a jerk, do this and this. Hilary got a lot of a good life event, advice, and more of a balance and letting things go and just kind of going with flow and other aspects of Miyagi-Do that Daniel probably wasn't privy to.
Yeah, because the whole thing with her character was, like, her parents died in a car crash, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So that's how they kind of were. He understood the loss, and they kind of got together on that angle.
Yeah. Yeah. So yeah, that'd be kind of nice, yeah, to see kind of her come back. Maybe, you know, bring that back. So is there anything else? Is there any negatives for you guys that you guys didn't like about the season?
The only real big negative, we gotta do something with Sam LaRusso besides her being kind of really bitchy throughout this entire season. Tori's trying to get her life together, and understandably, she's a little suspicious of it, but by a certain point, like, by, like, the, like, eighth, yeah, seventh episode, it was getting annoying.
At first, it's understandable. She legit, yeah, tried to kill you.
Yeah, she tried to kill you twice.
Yeah. Exactly. I understand, but when at a certain point Sam's mother comes into it and tries to help out, there's a point when there's a certain party going on where I was just like, Sam, let it go. Just stand back, let whatever happened happens, and just let it go. Because there's no need to fight anymore.
Right.
Wait until the tournament and just let it go. There's no reason to antagonize. She's not doing anything to antagonize you anymore, and even her mother has to step in again for Tori, where she's like, hey, try to not be awful to my daughter. And then I like her reaction where she, like, Sam, like, gets aggressive, goes first, and she's just like, oh, crap. Mm-hmm. Like, yeah, no, Sam's not taking it anymore. And she has kind of transformed throughout a lot of the series, is no longer being passive.
Yeah.
So I'm curious to see her kind of rein that back in.
Yeah.
He does need a lesson on humbleness.
Yeah, with the Sam and with the Robbie character, seeing them kind of take the lessons of Miyagi-Do and of Cobra Kai, because, you know, in this season, like we talked about, you know, Daniel is training, you know, his students as well as Johnny's students. You know, Johnny's doing the same thing with the Miyagi-Do students. He's teaching them the style of Cobra Kai. And to see both Robbie and Sam kind of both combined and meld those styles together, and to try to, you know, really create their own type of style, you know, like I said, Grey Jedi, you know, type of thing they have, like, yeah, Ahsoka Tano, yeah, something like that.
Yeah, to an extent, her, Robbie, and Hawk, they all kind of, this is like the season where they're taking lessons from everybody.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And I'll defend Samantha a little bit because, I mean, there's a situation where all this is because that Daniel can't let go of a 50-year high school beef.
So absolutely, I understand.
So
yeah, no.
Absolutely.
This series would not have started at all as if he just let Johnny make his karate. If he had just not done anything, none of this would have happened.
Yep. So
it's all ego. It's all ego.
So I see your point. Morris Dog in the chat asks, who are your guys' favorite characters? I'll let you guys go first. I'll get mine.
Shit. I think the best character in the show is easily, but my favorite, at least for this season, was Hawk, who's played by Jacob Bertrand.
Mm-hmm. Mm. Okay. You said, let me say, you cut out. You said, who's your favorite character? You said you cut out.
Yeah, my favorite character this season was Hawk.
Hawk, mm-hmm. Okay. No, before Hawk, before you said Hawk, who...
Oh, Miguel, I think, is the best written character on the show.
Best written character. Dusk, what about you?
My personal favorite is Hawk, and he's been my favorite, and it's been interesting seeing him develop and redeem and grow and change, and it's nice to see kind of his transformation in this season as well. Mm-hmm. I like it a lot. He's probably my personal favorite, but you are right. Probably the best written, or at least the most character given, is Miguel. And the actor who does Miguel, he does a very good job. He does a good job for what he's given, and he does it more than just the other characters. He kind of rises with it and tries to do something with it. And then I have to remind myself, wait, this is a Karate Kid series. What is this? But he's trying, and I applaud him for taking that material and trying to do something with it. There's a moment where he's talking to Johnny, and Johnny's drunk, and they have this moment, and then he says something, and my heart just broke for Miguel.
That was a heartbreaking moment. Yeah, that was.
And he starts tearing up, and I'm just like, it's gonna be all right.
Yeah,
it's okay.
That was a hard one. Yeah, and the relationship kind of gets strained in this season between Miguel and Johnny. To the point, you know, because you know he's getting a little jealous of Danny teaching Miguel, and you know, feeling no strain on that relationship, and so much so it's even affected, you know, his bedroom performance. You know what I mean? Like,
no, jeez,
what the fuck?
Yeah,
don't get it twisted though. Danny is the real villain here, and he's always against Johnny from the very beginning.
Yeah.
Don't think that him training Miguel wasn't a power move.
You think so? I think he was just, I mean, that's what they were doing. I mean, they were,
I have to question every decision Danny makes, because Danny and Johnny are complete opposites. I read this great comment in a YouTube comment for one of these videos just on the Karate Kid. And someone put it the best. Johnny teaches karate. He has the right intent for the right reasons, but he teaches it the wrong way. And Daniel teaches karate the right way, but for the wrong reasons. He's doing it for Danny teaches it for ego. Johnny taught it to defend people's self, but Johnny teaches karate incorrectly. And Miyagi-Do is a correct defensive, actually react against fighting. Don't just go looking for fights.
Yeah,
and I think that's an interesting dynamic that's going to get introduced in the next season with the return of possibly one of the greatest characters of the Karate Kid franchise.
Oh, yeah, from the second movie.
With the return of, spoiler alert, with the return of Chosen.
Yeah.
Who... I did not expect him to come back at all, and when he popped up on screen, I straight up just
that was pretty.
This show has just a talent for just making you go yes, yes, we're gonna do this. It's stupid, but we're gonna do this.
Yeah, it makes you care about characters that you didn't think you would care about ever. Yeah. You know what I mean? Like from Karate Kid 2, and because like Nick said, it's like this is really a series that's only had one good movie, really, or one great one, and that's the first
one. Two good movies.
Well, two good ones.
Yeah. One and a half, maybe two.
Yeah. And so it really makes you care about all these other different characters. Like, oh, they brought Terry Silver back. Oh shit, they brought Chosen back. Like, you know what I mean?
They brought that insane cokehead back.
Yeah.
Yeah, pretty much.
To answer his question, I forgot. My favorite characters, I like Robbie, and I'd say it's a tie after Robbie between like Tori and Miguel, I would say. I like their arcs throughout the show. It's pretty nice. And like to Dust's point about bringing up that YouTube comment about the different ways that they teach their karate, Daniel and Johnny. It's about, you know, like I said, when with the Hawk character is a perfect example of that, of, you know, bully nerd who tried to learn this to protect himself and how it kind of spiraled out of control. And now he's kind of back more centered. And it's the thing that, you know, what made him kind of feel that power was the confidence of being good at something, in which the girl mm-hmm. mentioned to him, you know, who's back being his girlfriend now, the hippie girl. I forgot a character's name. What's her name?
Moon.
Yeah. Moon. Yeah. Moon. So it was about that, you know, what made you good was, you know, you can like what you like, you know, you can be a nerd and that's fine. You can be all into this nerdy stuff, but it's being confident in yourself and believing in yourself that you can be good. And I think that's what's most important. Not the fact that you can just punch somebody in the face, you know what I mean? Or you could just be a violent bully. You know, it's like the fact that you actually are a good person and you believe in yourself and you have confidence in yourself. So I thought that
she
was
left him. Yeah, she left him because he got drunk on power.
Yeah, you know what I mean? And, you know, so now he's back being balanced and being centered in where he was. So, yeah, to see his progression, his character has been really one of the great things with his series. Yeah, I thought this was a strong season. I'm interested to see where it goes. I give this season a very high tune in for me.
Yeah, this season very much as well. And I'll go a step further. Fan-fucking-tastic. Ooh. This might be... I think this might be the best season of Cobra Kai.
Yeah.
And it's kind of weird that it's gotten progressively better with each following season.
Yeah. Yeah. Dusk, what about you, man?
This is a solid tune-in. It's not the best series. It's not the most well-written. It's not the most... the greatest ever, but if you're looking for a good time and you're just looking to for a great pick-me-up series that just will carry you and give you lots of good energy and you just need a goddamn pick-me-up, tune into this is a fun time. It is a fun time.
Yeah, I'm kind of right there with you. I wouldn't say this is a great show. I wouldn't say it's the best written, the best acted, but I will say it's a goddamn blast.
It's a fun show. It's fun. Yeah, fun watching. I have fun talking about it. Every time I talk about it, I have a lot of fun talking about it. It's fun to binge the show. Like, they're only good 30-minute episodes.
The show is insanely bingeable.
Yeah.
We talked about doing this last week, and it's like, okay, I might need a week to get through it all. Nah, like one day, next episode.
Yeah. I thought we were going to talk about this last week when it came out, so I waited till 3 a.m. and watched all of it into the morning.
Wow.
Because I thought we were going to have a show on that day. Mm. And then I've said, oh, I guess we're not. Okay. Well, I've seen it all, so I'll be able to talk about it.
Yeah.
We do.
Yeah, some good dedication, Dust. Good dedication there. I'm going to have to give you a raise, you know, like I have gave Nick a raise, Nicholas there.
Thank you, master.
Yeah, bump you up from 0 to 0.00. Got to bump you up there. All right, people, that was our review for Cobra Kai, season 4. Going to be moving on.
Cobra Kai.
So if you guys had the choice, would you do Miyagi-Do or would you do Cobra Kai?
I think this entire season, the whole point is that the answer is somewhere in the middle. Both, yeah. If I can.
Both.
Yeah.
One from both. Yeah. But just maybe...
Cobra Kai in the morning, Miyagi-Do in the evening.
Yeah. But maybe, you know what I mean? Maybe have somebody else teach you. Maybe have one of maybe the younger character like Sam or Robbie teach you. Yeah. You know what I mean? Teach you both the styles. You know, not really Johnny or Daniel, maybe.
Yeah, they're not the best teachers.
Yeah.